Let's not deceive ourselves, but because we receive Christ as our Savior, we have the assurance of sin forgiven and the assurance of eternal life. Let's not kid ourselves. That means that everything's okay. Now let me read you from Exodus chapter 4. I'm going to read the first five verses. And if you've been with us on recent weeks, you know we have been looking into these early chapters of the book of Exodus, which focus on the person of Moses. The whole theme, of course, is about taking the Israelites out of Egypt in order to take them to the land of Canaan, where God is going to fulfill his purpose for them. But the hero of the story is Moses. And this reading I'm going to read from verse 1 picks up in the conversation Moses has with God at the burning bush. It occupies the whole of chapter 3, but continues here into chapter 4. And Moses answered, "What if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, 'The Lord did not appear to you'?" Then the Lord said to him, "What is that in your hand?" "A staff," he replied. The Lord said, "Throw it on the ground." Moses threw it on the ground, and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said, "Reach out your hand and take it by the tail." So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake, and it turned back into a staff in his hand. "This," said the Lord, "is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you." We're going to read only that far this morning. God asks some interesting things of Moses when he met him here at the bush. And there are two primary things that God asked him for. The first, which we looked at last week, when God said, "Take off your sandals, for the place where you're standing is holy ground." He asked Moses for his shoes. And I suggested last week that seems a rather strange thing for God to be interested in. We would have thought he'd have more important things to be concerned about than Moses' shoes. But immediately after that, God said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac and Jacob. I have seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out. I am concerned about their suffering. I have come down to rescue them. I will bring them up to a land flowing with milk and honey. I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them." Who's God talking about? He's talking about himself. 8 times, I'm going to bring you out and take you into Canaan. And I imagine Moses, listening to this, got very excited. They'd been slaves for many years. They'd been there for 400 years. For many of those years, they'd been slaves in Egypt. I imagine Moses was very excited. "That's fantastic, God. How are you going to do it?" Next verse, God said, verse 10, "So now go, I'm sending you." Beg your pardon? We talked about this last week. "I'm sending you. Moses, it is I who's going to bring the Israelites out of Egypt." The only explanation will be that God has intervened and God has done something. "But Moses, I'm going to do it in your shoes. Take off your shoes." If you trace Moses' shoes, it's a fascinating study. Wherever you place the soles of your feet, that'll be yours. Why? Because God is in your shoes. After 40 years, Moses said, "Our shoes did not wear out. We had resources that lasted for 40 years. Why? Because God was in his shoes. We talked about that last week. But the second thing God asked him for is crucial to the rest of the story. He asked him for his staff. Verse 2, "What is that in your hand?" Now imagine Moses probably turned and looked to remind himself, because this staff that was in his hand was the basic tool of his trade as a shepherd. He was out with his sheep when he saw this bush burst into flame and gone burning, and he went to see why the bush did not burn out. And probably it was so second nature to him to be carrying this staff, a shepherd's crook, no doubt a long one with a hook on the end with which he could herd his sheep, and also he could put the hook around the ankle of a sheep and haul it in if he wanted to check it, if it was not well or something else. "What is it in your hand?" "Well, it's my staff. Something that represents my livelihood for these past 40 years. Something that represents my income, that represents my security, that represents my well-being and that of my family." It also, incidentally, represented his failure, because 40 years ago, being a prince in Egypt, he had an opportunity, he thought, to release the Israelites. He wondered why the people didn't recognize that God was using him, but he killed an Egyptian. The body was found. He had to flee. Ended up now in the backside, it says, of the Midian desert for 40 years. This staff also represented his failure. In fact, all that constituted Moses' present life is symbolized by this staff. What is it in your hand? It's my staff. Throw it down, said God. And it says in verse 3, Moses threw it on the ground, and it became a snake. And he ran from it, as you do when you meet a snake. It was something now of which to be afraid. Previously, it had been a harmless tool in his hand, carried it with him every day. Probably put it by his bed at night when he went to sleep. He probably wouldn't do that again. Let his kids play with it on Saturday afternoon. Now it's become something deadly, something of which to be afraid. He ran from it. And then in verse 4, it says, the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. Now, I don't know if you know very much about snakes. When I lived for 2.5 years in Zimbabwe, I met a lot of snakes. And I learned one thing about snakes, and that is this: you never take a snake by the tail. If you take it by the tail, the dangerous part, which is the head, is loose. If you're going to take a snake at all, you take it by the head, you put your fingers behind its head and hold it tight there. And then if you've got the dangerous bit, the head, you're okay. I did once have a snake, not a big one, in my hand like that. And it wrapped its body around my arm and it began to tight. It wasn't a constrictor, but it held on pretty tight. At least I could look at it and say, hey, snake, you know, you may have your body wrapped around my arm, squeezing as tight as you can, but I've got control of your head, and that's a dangerous part. Moses lived in the Midian desert. Not only did he live in the Midian desert, but, and this is significant, and we'll see some of this on another week, but snakes were very important in Egypt. If you were to look at any ancient Egyptian relics or things in a museum, you'll almost certainly find a cobra somewhere, curled up, often its hood out, ready to attack. It was the emblem of royalty, a hooded cobra to protect the king, to protect the pharaoh. When I was last in the Egyptian Museum in Cairo, I was impressed with how many times a snake appears as a symbol of ancient Egypt. Because it was on the mask of the mummy of Tutankhamun, the discovery of his tomb about 60, 70 years ago created a lot of interest and still does today. But on the mummy of Tutankhamun, on his mask, are two cobras, and often there's one at the center in a position ready to strike. Moses knew all about snakes. Living in the Midian desert, he would have encountered them often enough, which is why he ran when it turned into a snake, because he knew they were things to be afraid of and to treat with respect. And now God says to him, take it by the tail. The kind of thing you never do with a snake. And I want to show you why this is saying, because of what happens to this staff in the course of time, that God is saying to Moses, in effect, Moses, I've given you a shock. This harmless staff that you've held in your hand for 40 years, put by your bed at night, having thrown it on the ground before me, you've discovered it's potentially a snake. Now take it by the tail. You take the harmless bit. Don't worry about the poisonous bit. If you take it by the tail, I'll look after the poisonous bit. And Moses took it by the tail, and it became a staff again in his hand. But not the same staff. It would have looked the same. It would have felt the same. Would have the same grain of wood and the same knots in the word. When he took it home that night, his kids wouldn't say, hey, Dad, that's a new staff you got there. It looked exactly the same as it did before, but it's a different staff Because in chapter 4 and verse 20, at the end of this conversation at the bush, let me read you what it says. So Moses took his wife and sons and put them on a donkey and started back to Egypt, and he took the staff of God in his hand. Have you noticed that? It's called the staff of God. It used to be the staff of Moses. Now it becomes the staff of God. Now, initially, this was to demonstrate that God had sent Moses and was to demonstrate it to the Israelites, although he uses it to demonstrate to Pharaoh when he goes to Pharaoh and Pharaoh does not let the people go. Moses casts his staff down again. It turns into a snake. And Pharaoh's magician said, hey, that's nothing. And they did the same thing, threw their staffs down. They became snakes. The only problem was Moses' snake ate their snakes and then he took it in his tail and it became a staff again. That flummoxed the Egyptian magicians a little bit. But there's more significance than simply a demonstration to Pharaoh, because the request was, how do the people of Israel know that God has sent me? That's what this is for. And I want you to notice what happens to this staff. You see, back in chapter 4 and verse 17, when Moses leaves, it says, take this staff in your hand so that you can perform miracles with it. Take this staff, Moses, so that you can perform miracles with it. Go to chapter 7 and verse 15. Go to Pharaoh in the morning as he goes down to the water. Wait on the bank of the Nile to meet him. And take in your hand the staff that was changed into a snake. Don't take any old staff. Take the staff that was changed into the snake. Verse 17, this is what the Lord says. By this you will know that I am the Lord. With the staff that is in my hand, I will strike the waters of the Nile and it will be changed into blood. And that's what he did in verse 19. Tell Aaron, take your staff and stretch out your hand over the waters of Egypt, over the streams and canals, over the ponds, over the reservoirs, and they will turn to blood. Blood will be everywhere in Egypt, even in the wooden buckets and the stone jars. And this, of course, was the first plague at which we'll look on another occasion. The first plague whereby God brought pressure against Pharaoh and against Egypt. And it was when Moses took his staff and he held it over the river that the waters turned to blood. Not just in the rivers, but the ponds and the lakes and even the buckets and the stone jars. Look at chapter 8 and verse 5. Next chapter. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron, stretch out your hand with your staff over the streams and canals and ponds and make frogs come up on the land of Egypt. Here he stretched out his staff again, and the second plague, frogs appear everywhere. You got to make a cup of coffee and you find it doesn't flow out of the pot. You wonder why. There's a frog in there. There are frogs wherever there's water. There's frogs in the bath, frogs in the teapot, frogs in the... everywhere. A plague of frogs. By the way, do you notice he says, tell Aaron, we'll look at that on another occasion, because Moses said, basically, here am I, would you please send Aaron? God was angry and said, all right, I'll send Aaron. Aaron will go with you. Aaron will do it for you, but you tell Aaron what to do. So you find Aaron figuring here. That's Moses' brother. And we'll look at that another occasion. But then in chapter 8 and verse 16, the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron, stretch out your staff and strike the dust to the ground. And throughout the land of Egypt, the dust will become gnats. So he takes his staff and he strikes the dust, kicks up a dust, and every particle of dust becomes a gnat. If you're in the desert, it's a lot of dust. And they become gnats. And gnats are everywhere. And by the way, up until now, Pharaoh's magicians have come along and done the same thing. But here, they run out of the ability. And they say in verse 19, the magician said to Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. We've gone so far. You know, you can counterfeit the work of God. We'll look at this on another occasion too, so far. But now they're out of their depth. Go to chapter 9 and verse 23. It says there, when Moses stretched out his staff towards the sky, the Lord sent thunder and hail and lightning flashed down to the ground. And this is the plague of the hailstones. Moses holding up his staff, thunder, lightning, hailstones beating down. Go to chapter 10 and verse 13. Moses stretched out his staff over Egypt, and the Lord made an east wind blow across the land all that day and all that night. And by morning, the wind had brought locusts. And then describes how everywhere is just totally covered in locusts till it all looked just black, and they devoured every bit of greenery and every bit of vegetation they could find. This was the plague of locusts. And it came, and Moses held his staff towards the east, and a wind began to blow. And then eventually, Pharaoh was ready to let them go from Egypt, and everything went fine till they came in chapter 14 to a Red Sea, and they could not cross the Red Sea. And in verse 16, God said to Moses, when they couldn't cross the Red Sea, raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea to divide the waters, that the Israelites will go through on dry ground. And Moses, as you remember, held his staff all night over the Red Sea. And when the morning came and the sun broke on the eastern sky, there was a pathway through the water. God had done it, but it was Moses holding his staff. Look in chapter 17. They got then across the Red Sea. They're now in the desert. There's no water. And it says in verse 6, the Lord said to Moses, walk on ahead of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and I'll stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink. And Moses took his staff, and he struck the rock, and water came out of the rock and supplied water for the people. Same chapter 17, they met their first enemy, the Amalekites. And it says in verse 9, Moses said to Joshua, choose some of our men and go out to fight the Amalekites. Tomorrow I'll stand on top of the hill with the staff of God in my hands. And you know the story, many of you. As Moses stood there with the staff in his hand, the Israelites in the valley began to prevail against the Amalekites. And when Moses maybe got a bit tired and the staff began to droop, or he stopped to scratch himself or whatever, the Amalekites would begin to gain ascendancy of the Israelites. He'd raise the staff again. The Israelites would gain ascendancy of the Amalekites, and the battle in the valley was in direct proportion to Moses holding the staff in the air. So his brother Aaron and his friend Hur stood on the side and propped him up. They sat him on a rock and propped him up so that he could hold his staff in the air. I mean, what an amazing way to fight a war. I'm sure Moses had his fun. I'm sure he thought, well, everything's fine. Moment, whew, relax, just stretch a bit. Oh, here's the Amalekite coming. He's coming, he's coming, he's coming. Whoop, got him. What's the teaching? It's teaching the victory over the enemies of God is never won. It is only ever received and appropriated by faith, as Moses on the mountain holds his staff in the air. And later, when God had given to Israel the Ark of the Covenant, the most sacred place where God said, there I'll meet with you, there I'll speak to you. There were three things placed in the ark. One was the tablets of stone on which were written the Ten Commandments. One was a golden jar of manna. The other was, it describes it as Aaron's staff that budded. Aaron's staff had been Moses' staff. And what happened years later was this. So the people came to Moses and said, Moses, who do you think you are? You read this in Numbers 16 and Numbers 17. Who set you up over us? Who do you think you are to lead us? We have better ideas than you do. And if not better, certainly equal ideas to you. Who do you think you are setting yourself up to lead us? Moses went to God and said, God, the people are in a rebellion. What do I do? And God said, get a leader from each of the tribe to bring his staff to you. And for Aaron to bring his staff from the Levites, the tribe of which Moses and Aaron were a part. And they brought their staffs, and they were to take them into the tabernacle and place in a row the 12 staffs representing every tribe. Aaron's represent the tribe of Levi in the Holy of Holies. Close the curtain, go home, have your dinner, relax, go to bed, get up, have some breakfast, and come back. When they came back the next day, they opened the curtain. The 11 staffs were exactly as they'd been when they left them the night before. But the 12th staff, the staff of Aaron, had budded and blossomed and produced almonds. And God said, in effect, the staff that has life in it is the staff of the person I have chosen. You see, when God chooses and God appoints, there's life in what they do. The life was not in Aaron. He could go to bed and sleep. The life is in the work that he and Moses were doing. And this demonstrates that. And later God said, put that staff that budded into the Ark of the Covenant as a permanent reminder, along with the Ten Commandments, along with the jar of manna, a permanent reminder of what this business is all about. The Ten Commandments represent the purpose of God. It expresses his character. The manna represents the provision of God. He fed them on the journey. The staff represented the power of God. I mean, this is an impressive staff, wouldn't you think? You hold it over the rivers and they turn to blood. You strike the water, frogs suddenly appear everywhere. You hold it in the air, thunder, lightning, and hailstones. You hold it out in the east, the wind begins to blow, and in come the locusts. You create a dust with it, and every particle of dust becomes a gnat. You stand before a sea you cannot cross. It's too deep and too wide. You hold your staff in the air, and the waters will open. You run out of water. You're in a desert. You strike a rock with the staff. You're fighting your enemies, and you stand with the staff of God in your hand, and you win the victory. Man, wouldn't you like a staff like this? This is not a magic wand, you know. This is the staff of God. And let me tell you something. You can have a staff like this, but you'll only get it the way that Moses got it. Do you know how Moses got it? What's in your hand? Will you throw it down? I want your shoes, Moses. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. I want your feet. Now I want your staff. You throw it down, and I want you to know that the staff in your hand is potentially dangerous. It's a snake. But you take it by the tail, the harmless part. I'll not only look after the dangerous part, but this will become the staff of God. Make sure you take the staff when you go to see Pharaoh. How many times did God say, make sure you take the staff with you? This symbolizes a transaction has taken place between Moses and God. This is not Moses' business. He's cast his business down at his feet and taken it up, cast down the staff of Moses. He picked up the staff of God. If you think this is a rather strange exposition of this passage, you've twisted things a little bit. I don't think so at all. You follow the staff through and see how that in itself becomes the symbol of God's activity. So if you and I are going to have a staff like this, we need to answer the same question that Moses was asked. What is it in your hand? What is in your hand? Can I ask you that question? What is in your hand? Would you throw it down? You might say, I don't know what's in your hand, but you might say, well, you know what I'm holding tightly to? It's my job, my profession. You know, we live in rather uncertain times. And I worked hard to get where I am. It's a good job. It's a noble job. It's a respectable position. And God says, will you give it to me? Will you lay it down? If it's right for you, I'll give it you back, but with a difference. You take it by the tail. You hold it lightly. Take the harmless part. And it'll become the job of God, the profession of God. This is God's profession in your life. And you go back into the same office and the same workplace. You look exactly the same, and nobody will notice anything different, except the focus will become different. What is God doing with me here? What is his agenda for me in this situation, it'll become the job, the task, the profession of God. Doesn't mean you're talking to people all the time. That isn't always appropriate in a work setting. But it does mean that the presence of God and the activity of God will characterize your life. Now, of course, as with Pharaoh's magicians, people will have another explanation for it. Of course they will, first. And they might even mimic it. But it'll be the life of God. But as you lay it down, he may not give it you back because it is his prerogative to give it you back or not give it you back. He may give it you back and say, this is something I would like you to use on the mission field. This skill, this task, this profession is wonderful, but will you take a cut in your salary and go to the mission field and serve in a need where this is not being met? Would you let him do that with you? What's that in your hand? You may say, well, it's a piece of paper. What kind of piece of paper? Well, it's my degree. It's my qualifications. I've worked hard at this. I've trained for this. I've looked forward to this. I'm now qualified to do what I've wanted to do for a long time. Would you throw it down? Would you give it to me? I may give it you back. And if I do, go ahead. But this is God's future. This is God's purpose that's being worked out. If I don't give it you back, don't worry. I've got something better. Maybe somewhere else. But would you let it go? It'll become the stuff of God if you do. It'll just be your stuff if you don't. What's in your hand? You might say, well, it's my checkbook, it's my credit card, it's my bank balance, it's my money, it's my possessions. I've earned every cent. It's legitimate. Good. Would you lay it down? You see, there's not a place where the snake is more comfortable than within the love of money. The love of money can become a snake pit because it drives you, and who you trample on the way is irrelevant to you. But if you lay it down and I give it you back, it's God's money, it's God's resources. What's that in your hand? Well, it's my future plan. I've got dreams, I've got ambitions, I've got goals. I've been working them out. Would you throw them down in front of me? If they're right, don't worry, I'll give you them back, but they'll be mine. But if they're not, I'll change them. That's my prerogative. Will you give them to me? Or will you keep it yourself? Are they going to be your dreams, and your vision? Or will you let it be God's dream for you? What's that in your hand? Well, it's my family. They're a gift to me from God, my wife, my husband, my children, my grandchildren. We have a lovely home. Your marriage, your family, whatever it is, lay it down. I had a letter this week from a lady, a sad letter, and we've been in correspondence, longing to have children, and we understand that. That is a natural maternal desire, but after several years of IVF treatment, not able to have children, and she is so discouraged, she said to me, should I leave my husband in order that he might find a wife who can bear him children, because it breaks our hearts. We can't have children. I understand the pain of that. But I said to her, will you release your life as it is to God with no strings attached? I have no idea what his plan for you is, nor is it my business to know his plan for you, except that he has one. It does not include children. You will one day be thankful that it released you to fulfill what is his plan, because he does all things well. Don't begrudge your lot in life.
Give it back to him. Lay it at his feet. And when he gives it back, it becomes his marriage, his family, his children. What's that in your hand? He might say, well, it's somebody else's hand. It's my girlfriend, my boyfriend. I love them very much. He's a good guy. She's a great girl. Would you not throw her down, gently put her down? Would you give her to me? You see, there are a lot of Christians holding the wrong hand. And while you're simply holding her hand, it's fun. But you shed the tears later. Would you lay her down, him down, at his feet? You say, but this may be my last opportunity. If I let her go, if I let him go, I may not get somebody else. And you know something? God will never force you. He'll never twist your arm and make you do what he wants you to do. If you want to keep the girl, keep the girl. But you'll keep the snake as well. And you don't know when that snake will uncoil, but it will. And if she's right, he'll give her you back. But she's God's girl, God's man for you. This is God's marriage. We're not in this to exploit each other. We're in this together to serve God. What's that in your hand? Well, maybe it's your Christian service. Maybe you're active in some form of ministry. Maybe you lead a small group, or you teach a Sunday school class, or you teach some other class, or you're involved in the youth ministry, or you're an elder, or you're on the board, or you're a member of staff of this or some other church or mission. You sit on a committee. You lead a short-term mission. Would you lay it down? Because if you don't lay this down at my feet, it'll be your small group, your Sunday school class. It'll be your agenda every time you go to a board meeting or a staff meeting or a committee meeting. And that's the last thing any church needs. It needs men and women who say, what is God's agenda? What is God's purpose? What has God said about our function? What is the Spirit of God leading us and guiding us? And that, period, is our agenda and our interest. Otherwise, every committee meeting you go to, you'll take the snake with you. And he won't sit quietly in the corner, you can be sure of that. That's why so many churches are riddled with conflict and dispute and antagonism, because there's snakes all over the place that no one's laid down at his feet and said, Lord, forget about what I want or what somebody else wants or she wants or he wants. Lord, what do you want? That was the whole point of putting the staffs in the Holy of Holies and God demonstrating that Aaron's would bud and blossom and produce almonds, because life was in that, because that was God's agenda. Everybody else had their own agenda. And that's why Israel spent so long in the wilderness. And over the years, I've sadly seen situations when God does a work and people start to take possession of that work as though it were their own. They try to take possession of their church as though it was their own little private fiefdom of some kind. And they begin to adopt their own plans, and they begin to dream their own dreams, and they begin to visualize their own visions. As in the book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah says about the prophets and the shepherds who are the leaders of the people, they dream visions from their own minds and not from the mouth, notice, of God. but if they'd stood in my counsel and listened. Jeremiah 23, it's a frightening chapter to read for those of us who are in ministry. We put it down at his feet, and what it gives back, we take gently by the tail. Hold it lightly. It's not yours forever. Hold it lightly. What he doesn't give you back, he'll give you something else. And what's that in your hand? And some of you may say, it's myself. I've never given myself to God. Let's not deceive ourselves that because we receive Christ as our Savior, we have the assurance of sin forgiven and the assurance of eternal life. Let's not kid ourselves. That means that everything's okay. Paul, writing to the Romans, presenting an explanation of the gospel that's as full as any explanation in the whole of Scripture, comes to his 12th chapter. Therefore, because of the gospel he's explained, Christian people, therefore, present your body as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God. It's your reasonable service. Some translations say it's your spiritual worship. And to assume that that can be taken for granted would be a great mistake. To assume because somebody's a pastor, you can take for granted that his life is surrendered to God would be a great mistake. We need to come back every day. Lord, here I am with all the flaws and all the frailties and all the weaknesses and all the errors and all the mistakes and all the lack of discernment and all the problems that I know. Make me what I am. All of us need to say, Lord, here I am. I'm available to you. It's your business. I know there's a snake who's very, very, very interested. I'm not even going to fight him. I'll take the tail. This is your business. My focus is on you, not on him. My focus is on you, not on the enemy. You look after the serpent. And if you're not sure, by the way, who's the snake? You know who the snake is? It's his most common guise or disguise. From Genesis to Revelation, the devil appears as a serpent. First in the Garden of Eden, Genesis 3, the serpent was more crafty than any of the other wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say? By the way, you look at the times Satan talks in the Bible, which isn't very often. He always asks questions, and the questions are designed to sow doubt. Did God really say? So he comes. He's crafty. He's subtle. Don't think he appears, you know, with big horns, the kind of way that we depict him, and you'd be scared even if you saw him. No, no. He appears very beautifully, very attractively, with very reasonable questions. Is this really what God wants? In the book of Revelation, chapter 20, the end of the book, that ancient serpent, it says, who is the devil or Satan. I just give you those examples from Genesis 3 to Revelation 20. The serpent is the devil, and he is always, always destructive. He is never, ever your friend, though you may like his arguments. And you might like his scheming. Wouldn't it be wonderful to eat bread after 40 days in the desert? No, said Jesus. It all looks good. If you're the Son of God, get yourself known. Question. If you're the Son of God? No. It looks attractive. But he'll leave you destroyed. Do you know why Moses was so used of God? Because he gave God his shoes. You can walk anywhere in my body. It'll be God in my shoes. You walk in my shoes. And he gave him his staff. And that staff became the symbol of a transaction that had taken place. Take the staff when you go to Pharaoh. make sure it's the staff that was turned into a snake, that staff. Through the staff, you perform miraculous signs, not because it's a magic wand. It's a symbol only of a transaction between you and God. So when you stand at the Red Sea, you say, this is not my business, this is God's business. I'm not here to get us across the Red Sea. This is God's business, that's the symbol of it. This is God's, and God opens the water. You're out of water, it's not my business, it's God's. Strike the rock. You're fighting the enemy, it's not my business, it's God's business. Hold the staff in the air. When the leaders come and threaten them and say, who do you think you are, setting yourself above the rest of us? Well, let's see what God has planned. Who has God chosen? And it's Aaron's staff, the buds and blossoms. Same staff. Moses had given it to Aaron. It's now identified with Aaron. He gave it to Aaron in Exodus chapter 5. Same staff. I want to ask as I finish this morning, what is it in your hand? Because it's likely to be something very precious to you that gets in the way of God, not something that doesn't really matter very much. It's likely to be something very important to you that gets in the way of God, because I'm clinging to this. God, I'm glad you give you that. I mean, take as much of that as you want. I don't like it anyway. But no, not this, not this, not this. Would you lay it at his feet? And you can do that this morning. We're going to pray in a moment. I don't know how it is that God has spoken to you, but my prayer has been that he will. And how he speaks to you is entirely his business, because the issues that he is talking to you about are between you and him. But will you say, Lord, I lay this down. And unless he does something very different with it, you take it back and go home. But it's his prerogative now to do what he wants. And go back to the same place of work tomorrow morning. And everything will look the same. You will look the same. But it'll be the staff of God. And just trust him. And see what his business is. Your family can change. Your marriage can change. And you say, Lord, I give it to you.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price.
Have you ever felt inadequate for a task that someone wants you to do? Maybe you've been asked to bring a potluck dish, but your cooking skills aren't great. Your church wants you to teach Sunday school, but you don't like kids. Your boss asks you to do a presentation when you know you're not good at public speaking. Or God may call you to do something you don't like to do, something you don't feel you're good at. And you're not alone. The Bible is full of stories of people given tasks by God, tasks they didn't feel equipped to do. God asked Moses to go to Pharaoh to bring the Israelites out of Egypt. And Moses' response, "Who am I?" Moses felt inadequate.
The best people to do a task are people who don't actually want to do it, because they are less likely to have their own agenda.
This story sets the scene for a new series from Bible teacher Charles Price. It's called, Here I Am, Send Someone Else. You might think you're not equipped to do God's work. You might even be unwilling. But here's the good news, God can still use you. This new series of messages from Exodus will explain how you can experience God working through you. This series will help you overcome your fear and unlock your hidden potential. You can do what God wants you to do because it is He who will do it through you.
Write to Living Truth to order by mail. Or call Canada, +1 416 222 3341, extension 113. Or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca.
The desert is God's big picture book in the sand with amazing truths to discover if we'll just look and learn. We remember pictures long after words are forgotten, and as I stand here in the desert, I want to give you one of those pictures which is painted in Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 5 to 8. This is what the Lord says: "Cursed is the one who trusts in man, who depends on flesh for his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. He will be like a bush in the wastelands. He will not see prosperity when it comes. He will dwell in the parched places of the desert, in a salt land where no one lives. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in Him. He will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought, and never fails to bear fruit." Jeremiah contrasts two types of plant, the bush and the tree, and in doing so gives the answer to the question which anyone coming into the desert for the first time is immediately prompted to ask: how do you survive in the desert? And not just survive, but bear fruit? It's simple, says Jeremiah, through his picture of the bush and the tree. You have to put down roots. As you can see, a bush in the wasteland has very little root. It gets blown about by the wind and is therefore at the mercy of the elements. It never settles in one place. It has no sense of belonging. And if passers-by were to look to it for fruit, they would be disappointed. Here's the simple principle: no root, no fruit. The tree, in contrast, is fruitful. Why? Because it has roots. One of the most common plants in the desert is the acacia tree. What you see on the surface may look small, but beneath, its roots are very tall, sometimes stretching down 30 feet below the ground to find water. Acacia trees survive in hot climates all over the world. They find their nourishment deep beneath the surface and can therefore survive in heat and drought. They need have no fear or worries about what's going on around them, because they're not dependent on circumstances. What an incredible picture of our lives. The explanation for the life each person you meet lies not in what you see in their public life, but what you don't see in their private life. Deep roots enable the tree not just to cope when things get tough, but to actually flourish. The tree described in Jeremiah didn't just randomly land and start putting down roots. It's been deliberately planted in the desert by the water. Knowing you're planted makes all the difference. You're not where you are due to an accident. You are there out of choice. Maybe not yours, but if you're trusting God to lead and guide, then you are where you are out of God's choice. And God is often referred to in Scripture as the farmer, the husbandman, and the gardener. When He plants, He provides, even in the desert. When you find yourself in the desert, trust you're planted. Trust the one who planted you will provide for you. Put your roots deep into Him, and Him alone.
No, need you, Lord. I just can't deny it. I was so wrong and I can't hide it. Humbly I come to you. I lay down my pride so you take control, please. I know I need another chance. I'll bow before your throne so that you sanctify. can change my life. I love you, I need you, I want you. Please come and dwell in my heart. Lord Jesus, please come and dwell in my heart. Sprinkle me with your blood, and I'll be as white as snow in my heart, Lord. Create me a good home, I want to please you every day, yes. Teach me how to work in your holy ways more than ever before. I need you, my Lord, I need you, my Lord. Come and dwell in my heart, in my heart, Lord Jesus. Please come and dwell.
I love you.
I love you.
I need you.
I need you.
Need to forgive me,
Lord. Please come and dwell in my heart, in my heart, Lord Jesus. Please come and dwell.
Come and dwell inside my heart. Oh yes, Lord, I need you, need you, I need you, I need you. Oh yeah, yeah.